Okay. Good afternoon to one and all. I would like to invite Ms. Munira Saleem, ma'am. She is an academic counselor at JKBK and Ravensha Study Center. And today we will be discussing on Samuel Jensen's essays, Obstructions of Learning. So I would request Ms. Munira, ma'am, to kindly start the session. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Hiba Madam. A very good afternoon, everyone. As Hiba Madam has already introduced the subject with you all, I should be starting with Samuel Johnson and his essay. Now, students, before I directly jump into the essay, I think it is my duty to give you a bit of information on Samuel Johnson. I think you have been doing a few classes I probably have attended on Johnson, so I will not go much deep into Johnson, but throughout my teaching career, whatever I have understood about this period and particularly what I have understood about Samuel Johnson, I'll give you a brief description so that you can have a better understanding of the essay. Because as we people in English literature feel, we do feel and we do teach it in that way, that we connect the author with his time, with his period. We connect the author that we are dealing with other writers of his period, with the historical background of the period and what all events took place in that period that had influenced the writer to write in such way. Now, it's comfortable. I think I'm comfortable with you, honor students. You are already there. You have joined. I think you will understand what I'm trying to say. If you do have doubt, then please unmute yourself and then ask me if you have any query, any doubt. And you are honor students, in English honor students, so you need to understand things very clearly. It should be very crystal clear for you so that these are the foundations on which you're going to build your career. You're going to build your future studies on this. So students, if somewhere, if I go fast or if I go above your head, then kindly let me know so that I'll try my best to make you understand, and so that it will, help you for your future endeavor in English studies. Now, students, I'm starting. I'll give you a brief introduction on Samuel Johnson. He belonged to 18th century, the most active period of English literature, one of the most active periods of English literature he was born in. And these changes, political changes, social changes, influenced this writer as well. Like other writers, it influenced him a lot. And due to his influence, he has written many essays. He has done his work quite keeping in mind the time period, the things that had happened around him. So what are they? I'll tell you so that you will understand him better and you will understand his essays in a better way, students. Now, Samuel Johnson, he was born in 1709 and he died in 1784. So typical, you can say, 18th century writer. Now, students, if you talk about Samuel Johnson, one thing comes into our mind, that he was the one who initiated the dictionary. That is the first thing that you must remember. Samuel Johnson was the first one to write the dictionary in English language. Now, I'll go to that part later, but I'll tell you something more about Samuel Johnson. As I told you, he belonged to 18th century, means it was the period of Restoration. Now, restoration means restoration. Students, till this period, there were lots of disturbances in England related to Catholic and Protestant beliefs. These Catholic and Protestant beliefs started from the reign of Henry VI, Henry VII, and Henry VIII. Then after that, Queen Mary came to the throne. Again, she was a Catholic, and again there was disturbance, and then she was followed by Queen Elizabeth, who sat in the throne. She was a Protestant, and again there was disturbance with the Catholics and Protestants. Okay, then after that, King James came. King James the sixth. He was the king of Britain. Okay, and not only England but of the Great Britain. Okay, including Scotland. He was the ruler, and he again continued with the Protestant beliefs. Though he was the son of Queen Mary, but still, he had his own Protestant beliefs. Okay, then after that, you see Charles I coming to the throne. And at that time, you must have read your last unit, your last what you call your papers, last honors papers. You must have studied that Charles I was executed. And then what happened? For 11 years, there was parliamentary rule. You must have read that as well. Okay, so these changes continuously happened. And finally, this period, 18th century period, was the period when after 11 years of parliamentary rule, finally, King Charles II was restored to the throne. Okay, now this just prior to the period of King Charles II, there was the rule of parliament. No king was ruling. There was no monarch. Spectacularly in England during those periods, Charles I was executed, and your parliament had taken the rule. Now during those periods, you will find that when parliament was ruling, many things happened that disturbed the society of England. The first thing you must have read was the Great Plague that killed many, many people in England. Okay, the second thing was the Great Fire in London that also disturbed a lot. So now people were scared that if during this parliamentary rule there are so many disturbances going on, plague and fire and all. Okay, so they were scared. They thought that just because the king is removed, there is no monarch. They felt that king is the is a representative of God. So when king is not there, maybe England is facing so many hard and harsh days.
Ma'am, your voice is not audible.
Not audible? Is it cutting or it's completely inaudible? Eba, madam, please do let me know. Can you hear?
My voice is coming a bit low.
Speak louder.
No, it's a bit low. It's a bit low.
Okay, is it okay now? Excuse me. Is it
okay? No, a bit more. It's very low. It's very low. Earlier okay, it was better, but this time volume is turning very low.
I feel there is some problem with the connectivity. Should I, increase my voice? Should I, speak louder?
Debashri sir, would you be able to suggest her how can she make the volume a bit louder, something like that? Would you please assist her?
No, ma'am. Ma'am's voice is clearly audible to me, for me.
Okay.
Debashri sir, please do assist her technically.
Heba, madam, I think so. There's some problem with your system. Probably others can hear me.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, others are able to hear you. Okay, then fine.
I probably, probably.
Okay.
Students, let me hear from you. Students, can you hear
yes,
me?
Yes, ma'am.
One of you, kindly unmute yourself and let me know. Can you hear me, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Chandrasekhar, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So, do you think I should continue?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Chandrasekhar, can you understand what I'm telling, what I'm teaching? I'm trying to be a bit brief. I want you to understand the things going on in our at this time in 18th century. So are you getting what I'm saying? Chandrasekhar, let me know. Are you getting my points that I was telling you? Okay, maybe. You are understanding now, students. I think I was in at that time when King Charles II was restored, and generally, people, as I told you, that believed that
you know, the disturbance, the social disturbance is going on, and there are health hazards. There's no king, so they should restore a king. And this is one of the pertinent reasons why King Charles II was asked to come back to the throne after the execution of King Charles I. Now, at this time, King Charles II comes to the throne, and that is why this period is known as Restoration Period. Restoration, or you may call restoration, when the king was restored to the throne. Okay. Now, so this period is known as Restoration Period, students. But if you see this period, if you have read the last units, you would have find that so many things happened. And, you know, this particular period is known for by so many names. Like we call it a neoclassical period, okay? Then we call it Age of Reasoning and Age of Enlightenment, Glorious Revolution. Okay, so many names have been given to this period because lots of changes came, and also, you know, people started to think scientifically. That is one of the reasons why we call it Age of Reason. Okay, people started reasoning things, and the same thing you will find it in literature, where you see the literature was also, you know, getting filled with the writings which had some reasons, with some some values, some reasons. Okay, like cause and effect thing. Okay, so these things started with our literature, and you can find, if you see, this is also known as Augustan period, neoclassical period, because people felt, these writers, our people from literature, they felt that the real reason or the real nature of reason could be found from classical periods, the period of Homer, okay, a period of Virgil. So they revised some of those works from classical period, from old periods, old times. Okay, and also they, in their original writings also, to a large extent, they imitated their style. Okay. There was a breakage in the link. Debashish sir, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, there was some problem, and one of the students, I think Chandrasekhar, I got the message that he's not able to hear me. Chandrasekhar, can you hear me now? Chandrasekhar, can you hear? I think there's some problem with his connectivity. Can you hear Chandrasekhar?
Ma'am, the voice is not clear.
Okay, I think Chandrasekhar, there's some problem with your connectivity, because here the technicians can hear me. Probably other students can also hear me. Chandrasekhar, kindly check your net.
I would like to Chandrasekhar, rejoin the meeting. First of all, leave this, and again you will be rejoined, but audible then. Okay.
Chandrasekhar, log out and then log in. Okay. Yes, left. There is a consistent problem with the net for all of us. Chandrasekhar, you have joined. Can you hear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Chandrasekhar, very good. I think now I should continue. And so I was in this new classical period. Okay, now this writer started writing, reflecting things, and also imitating from those classical periods of Homer and Virgil. Now, this is the reason why this period is known as new classical period, and also this is known as Augustan period. Augustan period, because for the more or less for the same reason, because of Caesar Augustus. Caesar Augustus was the king during this classical period. So when these writers of 18th century, they imitated the style of writing from that period, from the past, from the classical period, they are known as Augustan writers, Augustans. Okay, just because they imitated, they were influenced by the writings of those writers who belong to Caesar Augustus, the king, the ruler. Okay, now this is the reason. And now coming to Samuel Johnson. Samuel Johnson also believed, he was a hardcore believer of realism. Okay, he believed that realism should persist in our writing, and that would create an excellency in our art, in our literary art. Okay, and also he believed in the imitation of nature. We should imitate nature in our writing. What he is trying to say is that we should have some influence of the natural environment, the nature in our writing. We should feel just like Wordsworth later in 19th century, he told that nature is our guide. So back in 18th century, this Samuel Johnson and, you know, writers of his sort, they also believed that nature should influence a writer. Okay, because that is the basic. And the writers who believed in realism also believed in the basic elements of life. Now, in this period, 18th century, again, you see, you know, so many periods are there here, you know, so many happenings happen in our literature. Also, you must know that during this period, only novel writing initiated. Okay, novel writing, like Daniel Defoe started his writing, and females like Aphra Behn also came to the forefront of literary writings. Okay, now with this Samuel Johnson, firstly, he became very famous for his essay on the writings of Shakespeare, and he named it as Preface to the Writings of Shakespeare. And he became very famous for that because, you know, Shakespeare was already a reputed writer, but the preface that was added by Johnson gave much more reputation to Shakespeare. Okay. And also not only Shakespeare, but many writers, English poets, they also got a proper canon of writing through the essay or through the criticism written by Johnson, by Samuel Johnson on the different poets, English poets. Okay. Now you can say that he was Samuel Johnson was an essayist, was a writer, he was a critic also. Okay, a very, very intelligent criticism he used to make. And sometimes, you know, you will find his criticism very directly hitting as well. Okay, now he also had a lot of belief and commitment towards reasoning that I told you. This was the age of reason. Johnson also believed in the reason. He believed in truth. He believed in the scientific approach of life. Okay. And also he believed that there should be some influence of history. Historical influence should be there within us for our the advancement of our intelligence. We should reflect back to history. Now by history they mean classical periods. Okay. Now this was a little bit about Johnson. Okay. And he also believed that the writers in the coming age, for the writers of the coming age, for the gradually time will be advancing. So for writers, only books should not be the only mode of learning. Okay, for an intelligent person, experience is important, exploration is important, your natural learning is important. So just, you cannot limit yourself confined to books when you are seeking for knowledge. If you seek for knowledge, you need experiences. Okay, that only books cannot provide you. So you need to live in the living world. You have to be a part in the living world so that you can learn, you can experience, you can feel, And then when you read, your knowledge will be quite broad and quite exhaustive. This is what is Samuel Johnson's idea. Another important thing, and that is why he became the believer of realism, and along with realism, just like other writers who believed in realism, he also believed to be morally strong. Okay, you are realistic, you are scientific, that's okay, that's very fine, but one must not leave one's morality. You should be morally upright as well. These were the beliefs of Samuel Johnson. Now, at this time, students, what you will observe here, that it is 18th century. If you go a bit back, if you go to 17th century, a bit more back, 16th century, a bit more back to 15th century, you see Chaucer, Age of Chaucer, you see Age of Shakespeare, you see then metaphysical poets coming. What you find in these writings of these writers, these poets and playwrights, what you find is there's no stable English language. Okay, Shakespeare, he used his own style, his own methods. He was very creative and experimental with his language, you know, with the production of language, Shakespeare. If you see Chaucer, Chaucer had a lot of Latin influence. He had a bit of French influence also, Chaucer. Shakespeare, you see him, you know, he's a master of his own will when he is up to language production. Okay, if you move a little ahead, after Shakespeare, if you see metaphysical poets, they used very, you know, exhaustive language, very sophisticated method of, you know, language production. Then what you see is that through these ages, down these ages, what you find is that language is not static. Okay, writers, they are using, they are playing with words according to their own way. So there is no proper vocabulary, there is no proper spelling, there is no proper punctuation. There is nothing static in English language production writing. Now, that is why what Samuel Johnson did is he wrote a dictionary. Okay, now for us down the years, dictionary usage means when you want to need to know the meaning of the word, then we search for dictionary, isn't it? Some meaning we don't know, we need to know the meaning. So I ask you to refer to the dictionary. But the purpose of the creation of dictionary was not to seek for the meaning. It was to stabilize English. It was to stabilize the vocabulary, to stabilize the language, the word formation, okay, the sentence formation. So that was the aim, a basic aim of writing dictionary for Samuel Johnson. But down the years, dictionary has become word and the meaning, synonyms. But it was not so. So when he created dictionary, when he wrote the dictionary, he became very famous for that. Okay, he became very famous for that. And that is why he was honored the doctoral post for the position, the doctoral, honorary doctoral degree, it was conferred upon him. And that is why he is most famously known as Dr. Johnson. Okay, for his contribution in the English, for the contribution of stabilizing English language. Okay, now moving ahead. If you see a little bit of the background of Samuel Johnson, you will see that his childhood was not that a happy one. He came from a poor background. He had a poor family. Okay, but later when he started writing, he slowly and gradually became famous, and that made him gain his reputation and also a bit of wealth. Okay. Moving on to your particular essay, today's essay. Narratives of Travelers. I have the next one to teach you today. Obstructions of Learning. I'm supposed to explain to you Obstructions of Learning. Now, students, when I have given you the background of Samuel Johnson, you could have made a picture in your mind what kind of person is Samuel Johnson? And now if you now see your obstructions of learning, you can attach a bit of historical background of Samuel Johnson with that of what he has trying to say, what he has been trying to suggest. Now, as I told you that this was the time of reasoning. Now, this time of reasoning, he is also, he is also making a critique of the process of gaining knowledge in obstructions of learning. And he is also trying to say that what is obstructing us from learning. Okay. Now, in this time, when I ask you what is obstructing you from your studies, first you will say your laziness. Because sitting and studying is a difficult task. You need a lot of patience. You need to control your other feelings that often, very often makes you waver. Okay, so you need a lot of focus, a lot of willpower needs to be involved when you are sitting to study. Okay, but I think very recently, if you are sitting at home and with this lockdown issue, then you must, if you are up to some kind of learning, then you must have seen that this time for us is a very qualitative time for study. We are sitting at home, we are at leisure, and at this time, if you have lure towards learning, then you must have felt quite soothing and comforting to sit and study, okay, and enjoy and get the pleasures of study. But very often it happens, students, for I think all of us, okay, for we teachers as well, that happens, that sometimes we lose our patience studying. Sometimes our study is not able to capture us. And what happens once we stop the practice of studying, stop the practice of reading, it gradually goes away. Okay, so when you are up to studies, okay, when you are into studies, when you are continuing with your studies, and if you continue, that becomes a habit. But once if you are broken with studies, then to sit back and study is very difficult, because yeah, Johnson is also trying to suggest the same thing. He is trying to say that studying and gaining knowledge is just like meditation. Okay, you may take it in many other ways, that it is as pure, as chaste as meditation also. And actually Johnson is trying to say is that you need a lot of patience. You need lots and lots of willpower. Your self-controlled will you need to sit and study. Okay. And that is very much like meditation. Once you develop it, okay, you start advancing each day. But again, apart from this willpower, there are many other problems of learning. Suppose you are not able to pick a good book. Sometimes your selection of choosing a book gets wrong. Okay. And that irritates you. It sometimes irritates you so much that you stop studying. So these are the hazards of, or these are the obstructions of studies, of learning. Okay, but if you keep on studying and if you keep on selecting, if you don't get yourself distracted from your selection of proper books that interest you, then you might go astray in your learning, or you may leave studying. But once you keep on meditating and you keep on choosing wisely what you need to learn, okay, you will be among those few knowledgeable people on earth who are the storehouse of learning, experience and knowledge. This is what is Samuel Johnson trying to say. Okay, now he's saying that it's a fantastic essay. These few lines are there. It's a very short essay, but it is trying to express so many things. It is expressing so many ideas and a very practical approach of learning and education, and the pros and cons sometimes you fall into without your knowledge with the process of learning. And sometimes when you fall to the darker side, you get distracted for learning. But if you are on the right track, then you are really a knowledgeable and an enlightened person. Okay, so this is enlightenment period. So he's talking about how you get that enlightenment if you are in the proper way. Now, in your initial classes in your first year when you enrolled, you must have studied Christopher Marlowe. Christopher Marlowe's Dr. Faustus. Okay. So Dr. Faustus was also one such character who was very educated, highly knowledgeable into, I think, everything. So the quest of more and more knowledge led him to do what? Led him to a wrong path when he, tried to read those, what they call black magic. There's some term used for that, and they sell the soul to Lucifer. Lucifer is the devil, Satan. Okay, so maybe his excessive education led him to the wrong track. When he sold his soul, he gave up his soul to Lucifer, and he did all sorts of ill things. So what ultimately, what I mean to say is that too much of education he got, and he wanted more and more and more. So that want to get more and more education led him to the wrong track, where he left morality and where he went after to the devilish thinking and devilish action. So this is one example that I remembered where while I was reading this essay, that Dr. Faustus is so practically true when you read Obstructions of Learning of Ben Jonson, that how a man gets obstructed, okay, when he tries to get more and more and more education. Okay, so here he says that, you know, when you are a young man, when you are young in age, you are a very enthusiastic learner, and you are continuously seeking, searching for knowledge. You want to progress yourself in your life. Okay, but as a young man, sometimes you move away from the path. Okay, now education is very often very fruitful. It's enlightening. Okay, it gives you knowledge, it makes you wise, everything. But sometimes education sometimes removes you from the right track as well. Okay, now he says that a young learner, he keeps on learning, but sometimes it so happens in his life that maybe he's a good student, but he gets distracted. And what distracts him? Usually young men are distracted by worldly pleasures, enjoyments, and all the new attractions they feel towards the world. Okay. And as a result, all their sincerity in their studies goes off. Okay. Just in search of pleasures, worldly pleasures. But you can see that your education, gaining of education and learning is something very much different from your worldly pleasures. You will get pleasure when you read, no doubt. But that pleasure is completely different. That feeling when you are reading, when you're getting knowledge, is something enlightening, is the word that we say. Okay, you get pleasure. But that enlightenment you don't feel when you are seeking for other worldly pleasures, your enjoyment, today's world you call it partying, enjoying. Okay, so those things are pleasures, but they distract you from the real and chaste and enlightening pleasure that is learning. This is what Johnson is saying. Also, he's saying that, okay, students are those who are there doing literary studies. Sometimes people of literary studies also, they also get, abstract. They also get out of the path without properly improving themselves. Okay, and what they do is that when they are studying, they sometimes feel like diverting their mind from studies. And once they divert in some other social activities, they are lost there. They cannot come back to their books. So he's trying to say is that your book should be your constant companion, your best friend. When you have the best friend as your book, then you're the wisest person. But that's not always possible for everybody. That is why the wisest person in the world are very few, are just handful. Those who know how to clutch on to education, they know how to clutch on to knowledge, because knowledge, students, is a thing that never ends. Okay, one life is too less to gain all the knowledge. So if you're getting more and more and more and more knowledge never ends. So even though we go old, we are knowledge seekers. And the one who thinks that he knows everything, his process of gaining knowledge stops. So that is what he's saying, that if you leave, if you see knowledge is so vast, and if you leave, if you stop it, and if you try to divert mind into something else, then that meditation is lost. Because that is the process through which you got real enlightenment, real knowledge. Okay, that is lost when you are after other pleasures, seeking for other pleasures of life. Students, give me just 1 minute. I'll drink some water and we'll be back. Okay. This is what he's saying. Okay, and then he says, sometimes men also fall due to the inadequacy of learning. Okay, means what it means to say is that by inadequacy, I mean that they go on learning and learning and learning. They try to get understand the truth of knowledge. They try to get wisdom, but they become sad when they get knowledge. Okay, because they feel that after you get knowledge, you understand the futility of life. Our life, our existence is so futile. It's so short span. It's so it's so temporary that we have to leave all this and go without getting all the knowledge of the world. So knowledgeable people also sometimes, after they get to know the truth of this life, the futility of life, they also sometimes get distracted from learning process. They feel anguished, they feel sad when they really understand the real meaning of our existence. Okay, but he's saying that one must not feel like that. We understand that our life is very futile, our life is very short, and we cannot get so much of knowledge. When we understand that, ultimately we feel sad, we feel anguished. Okay, but the feeling should not be so. We should continue. This kind of feeling sometimes misleads us and stops our process of learning. Okay, he's saying, Samuel Johnson is saying that learning is an asset. It's always an asset. Asset means a gift for us and a reward for us. Okay, it will always render benefits for us. So it is an asset. Okay, and he says that as he talks about paradox here, two things. He says that gaining knowledge and learning is privileged and abundant. Okay, this is the paradox. He says that the one who learns in a proper track is privileged. Okay, but he says that sometimes he feels abandoned also. Abandoned means left out. Okay, but this kind of thinking is not right. You must always yearn, you must always grow for more and more knowledge. Okay, and once if you feel some other way about education, about learning, then you leave learning, and then you cannot recover it in your life. The pleasure that you got from learning, the pleasure that you got from education is lost. Once you leave it, once you feel some other ways, so if you feel abandoned, or if you feel that what is life, it's so futile, then what happens? You lose. Okay, and that loss cannot be recovered. So if once you have started and cultivated the habit of learning and reading, that should continue. Okay, and then he says that suppose you leave it, okay, and you do not continue because of some reason you have stopped gaining knowledge, okay, then you may not complain because you have some excuses for your weakness. You have left it because of some of your weakness in your will or weakness in your thought. So you have left your learning, but you will not repent. You will not feel sad that you have left because you invent some excuse for yourself. So that is why he says the idler never applauds his idleness. Idler means one who passes away his time without doing anything. So he will never repent that he has wasted his time, because that was his will, that was his wish. Some excuse he can make to be an idle person. Okay. Or sometimes you had a lot of intelligence in your youth, but you never used it. When you grow old, maybe if you have no understanding, if you have no enlightenment, then you will not understand that you have wasted your time. That though you were intelligent, you did not use it properly. Because through that intelligence, you invent some excuse of not studying, of not gaining knowledge. And these are the reasons, these are the obstructions of learning that makes a very handful of the real learners. The rest, what they do is they quit. Even those who are there in the line of literary studies, they are also not a fully learned person. Okay, because in the process of learning, some way or the other, the reasons are given here, they get obstructed and they leave, they quit learning. They no more remain the true, they do not anymore remain the enthusiastic learner. Okay. Now he's saying that there are so many reasons that will stop you from gaining knowledge. Okay. And these hundreds and thousands of reasons are responsible to keep knowledge in the hands of few. Okay, knowledge is there around the world in only few hands, proper knowledge. Okay. So he says that apart from study, we have so much of work, so much of duty, so much of responsibility. Okay. But though you have a very wonderful line, he's saying that though you have your duties, your responsibilities, your work, but from this work schedule, you have to steal some time. Okay, just like a thief. Just like a thief, you have to steal some time from out of your work, okay, and divert it in studies. That means for him, he is trying to say study. Whatever you are doing, you have your jobs, you have your work, you have your responsibilities, you are busy person, but from out of that busyness, just steal some time, take out some time, steal it. Okay. Just like a thief, steal some time and study. Okay, because there is no pleasure more than the pleasure of studying. Okay, so these are the wonderful time that you spend after studying. Okay, and then he says that, but however, there are many other people, those who steal time out of their profession, but they have some other part-times, other pleasures. Okay. They have lavish lifestyles. They love spending their money. They love partying. They love wasting their time. Okay. But there is no calm delight. He says the word calm delight. There is no calm delight that you get from studies. That kind of pleasure, that calmness. Okay. The pleasure of your soul that you get is from education, from your studies. Okay, not education, but studies. Now, then he says that amount of time that you're taking out for your studies, that is a really powerful indulgence. That is a powerful indulgence that you are studying, that you are taking out time and studying. Okay, and you get some kind of unique joy. That joy that you get from studies, if you are getting real study and real enjoyment from out of your busy life, then that time is you know, something extraordinary. The joy that you feel when you're studying, that is really very soothing and comforting if you could feel that. Okay. Now, then he says our studies and our learning, it doesn't depend on time and place. Okay, it is not in the hands of time or place. Okay, and you cannot restrict it with some season or climate. You cannot say, aaj barsha hoche, aaj patho hai paribar. You cannot say that because your learning is in your hand. And in today's world, had Samuel Johnson been alive now in the time of information and technology, he would have got excited to see that how easy learning has become for us. sitting at home very comfortably or lying on our couch very comfortably, okay, the mobile phone in our hand, and we can read, we can study. Okay, so at that time also he's saying that an enthusiastic reader, an enthusiastic knowledge seeker will have no excuse with regard to time or place. If it is night, 3 o'clock, you cannot say that no, study is not possible. Study is possible at any time. Okay, and it is not confined to place also. That if you go to college or if you go to a university only, then you can study. Okay, so your study is not place bound or time bound or climate bound or place bound, season bound or city bound or country bound. Okay, so education, knowledge gaining and studies is as free as the breeze that is going, according to Samuel Johnson. Okay, so and then he's saying that if this feeling you have, that your education is not limited to space or time or locality, okay, then you may feel that you may feel when you read book really in any circumstance, then you will get the real pleasure. There will be no other pleasure that will surpass the pleasure of studies. Okay. Now, then he says, suppose you are studying and you are enjoying, you love it, but due to some reason, due to some occasion, or maybe due to some kind of neglect, and when you delay your studies, the study will go far, far away from you. Slowly, slowly, it will move away from you. Okay. It will, if you neglect it will neglect you. So you need to have a continuous habit. You have to make it as compulsory as your eating habit. Just like you eat 3 times a day, so that is going to be the food for your soul. So you have to make it habit, no neglect, no delay, no occasion, but you have to, and you have to sit and study. Otherwise, if you delay, what will happen? Your mind will slowly, slowly slip away from your control. Okay, and your attention will get diverted to some other things and engagements of life, and you will get completely distracted from studies. Only little neglect will make you completely distracted. So just see how studies is a very serious affair. You are students now, you are doing your undergraduations now. Sometimes you must be feeling bored, especially now when you are forced to sit here for 1.5 hour afternoon time, and teacher teaching Ben Johnson. So it was, you must be feeling sometimes so bored. Okay, and once if you feel bored or if you feel like neglecting it, leaving it, coming back to the track will get almost impossible. Okay, so gaining knowledge, you know, students, is very difficult. It's very difficult. You need lots and lots of patience. But you feel that once you have acquired it, you are a master of it. Okay. You will feel a compulsory urge to sit and study. Whether it's night, whether it's day, whether it's dawn, whether it's evening, whatever time it is, you will feel a kind of something, somebody is calling you to come and just sit for it. And once if you get distracted, once suppose you have some other work to do or other anywhere to go, if you start doing like that, your knowledge will slowly, slowly creep out of you, and it will go from you forever. So you need to hold on to the process of getting knowledge, because it is a process, and the process has to be very spontaneous. The process has to be a continuous thing. It is not going to stop in any condition, in any circumstance, in any situation. Now, we are very lucky people, 21st century people, we are so lucky. If books are not available, internet is available. Whatever knowledge, whatever book you need, you just tap it and you just at least get the information about the book. Or the if you want to read a novel, it's very urgent, your teacher has asked, you open the net and read the summary. It's almost done for you. Okay, so things have become so easy for us. So even more than the period of Samuel Johnson, we should be more attentive towards our studies. If you really want to keep the power in your hand, okay, then you need to keep knowledge in your hands. And that is, I think, more important than any other thing in the world. And for that practice, you need a very hard willpower that you are going to do, you are going to sit and you are going to make it. Now, Johnson is going back to Johnson. He's saying that, he's saying the same thing here, that if you once leave it out of some neglect, out of some reason, then your study is going to go away from you. So it is just like a very sincere love affair that you have to create with studies. You love studies, study will love you. If you try to neglect it, okay, it is just like a beloved. If you neglect her, she will not look back to you. Okay, so education is just like that, according to Johnson, Samuel Johnson. Okay, then he says, very wisely he says, very nicely he says, that it is customary. It is the very usual thing. It is nothing unusual about it. That when once you try to leave study because of some reason, okay, then your soul will shrink. Okay, it will try to run away from what is truth. Truth is education. Truth is studies. So slowly, slowly, your soul will shrink away. Okay. Because shrink away from what? From intellectual labor. Okay. When you're sitting and studying, you're laboring. You're working very hard. And that is intellectual labor. Okay. And it will go away for it. Then he says, and many other confessions he's making about learning, and sometimes many other reasons away from our, apart from our willpower also obstructs the process of our learning. He says that, he's saying that, you know, sometimes there are many things that hinders our process of learning, no doubt. Okay, sometimes you want to read, you are an enthusiastic learner, you want to learn. But sometimes what happens is that, as I told you, you choose some wrong kind of book. Okay. And you start reading, but you don't find interest. What you do? If you are bored, you just pile it off. You don't read. So some, that makes you obstructed from learning. Okay. If you have not selected a good book. Okay. So the selection of a good book is just like, according to him, selecting a silver from ore of lead. Okay, and he says that trash kind of writing, many writings are there, many books are there. Can you say, are all the books quality books? No, you cannot say. We have to make a selection. Okay, we have to be wise while selecting it. So when you are selecting book, you have to be wise. And once if you have selected a wrong book, okay, so it will distract you. So selection of a good book is just like picking silver out of the ore of lead. Okay, and the silver is usually mixed with the ore of lead. You have to be intelligent enough to pick it up and use it. Okay, one precious thing you have to pick up from the trash. Many writings are trash. Okay, because anybody writes and anybody publishes, there's not always surety that a book looks good and it will be good. Not like that. But you have to make a very careful examination of the book, be very careful, and you have to choose it. And suppose once you have chosen the wrong book, what you do is you make a general hypothesis that all books are fallacious, all books are wrong, they are not properly interpreting things. Okay, so that is not so. You have to be very careful while picking a book to read. First, you have to see, look at your choice. Sometimes quality is good, but that's not your choice. So you need to know your interest. When you came to know your interest, you have to search for the book that suits your interest, your attention. Choose for that book very wisely. Sometimes you can see through the reviews. This I'm telling, Samuel Johnson is not telling. Sometimes you need to see the reviews, some impressions of some writers. You just go through them, and when you find it close to your understanding, then you may get it. Otherwise, once if you choose a wrong book and if you don't feel interested, you make a general hypothesis that no, books are not valuable. That is not so. According to Johnson also, you have to be very selective while choosing books. Otherwise, it is going to distract you forever. Then he says that, okay, sometimes some books are imitations also. Some influence is there, some imitation is there, copying is there. So sometimes he says that imitation and repetitions are important. Okay, they are lawful. You cannot always say that repetitions are unlawful. Repetitions are lawful, especially with regard to history. History, in history you are repeating. A historian is repeating. Whatever has happened in the past, that is repeated. A historian repeats and puts the whole thing before you, okay, by stylizing it, okay, adds a little bit of stylization. Historian uses those techniques. He stylizes the writing style, he polishes the writing style, makes it makes it appealing also, so that readers will read. But what he is doing, he is repeating whatever had happened. He has just witnessed it and he has written it down, adding his skills. Okay, so always you cannot say that repetition is wrong. Repetitions are sometimes there. Okay, history is actually a repetition of the events. The historian just stylizes it. Okay, he makes it appealing, that's it. And he puts it before you. So that is a reflection. That is the repetition. So in some cases, repetition is acceptable. We read repetitions. Okay. Then he says, he's talking about bad writers. There are many writers. In history, reputation is okay. Then he talks about the writers, those who disgrace the writings. Okay, those are disgrace to literature, those who are disgrace to writing, those who are disgrace to creativity. Okay, and they are filling this world with all sorts of quality-less books. Okay, they are creating rubbish to the world, that's all. Okay, but if you see in a factual sense, then suppose he's talking about a travelogue. If somebody writes a travelogue, he says that I have visited that place and that place looks like this. This historical monument looked like this. Okay. Or the one who collects antique pieces. Antique pieces, many very rare old pieces, one who collects. And when he tries to write it. So what he has to do in his writing process, he has to make the depiction of that particular thing that is with him. Some antique is with him, suppose. Or suppose he has visited some place of a historic interest. So he has to write it in such a way that the reader will really find a picture of that place. Okay, so that is repetition. That is repeating in words whatever he has seen. Okay, but that repetition is acceptable. Every time repetition is not acceptable, most of the time it is trash. But for historians, for travelers, for the interpreter of antiquities, things are possible. Repetitions are possible. And he has to stylize it and present it in such a way that the reader will really find a picture of that place or of that thing. So that is accepted. Otherwise, rest is not accepted. And by chance, if you fall into some wrong kind of book, then you are completely misinterpreted. Sometimes you will get completely obstructed from the real word or real value of studies. This is there in your chapter, in your essay. I have explained it to you. Okay, now here it is saying that pertinent or very important hindrance to education, hindrance to learning. What is the most prominent hindrance of learning? Obstruction of learning. So you can say that the most important obstruction of learning is our mind. Okay, it's our mind, because sometimes our mind takes us to some other ways that goes apart from gaining knowledge. So our mind is the most responsible thing that is involved in the process of learning, and a lot of willpower is needed to learn. And once we get little bit of wavered from away from learning, then our process of learning is completely hindered and obstructed. Then he says, apart from this major our willpower, there are many other reasons as well, like the selection of wrong books, like the books that don't interest us. So they are also a hindrance to our learning, and also students, other worldly pleasures. For a young person, other worldly pleasures might seem more attractive, enjoy giving than the enjoyment of learning. So these are the reasons why a person usually gets obstructed from learning. This is the usual reason why most of us, very few people hold on to education and learning, but many people, I think 92, 93, 95% of the people of the world do not hold on to learning. Okay, as they start learning from their early childhood days, they continue learning till their adolescent period. But once there are many people who establish themselves, and after that they stop learning. So, and that is a very gradual hindrance, because this is an excuse that we usually invent. We say that we don't have time. Okay, we don't have time to sit and study. We have to work so much. These are mere excuses. If one really wants to learn, then as Samuel Johnson is saying, that you have to steal time from out of your profession or from out of your other leisure habits. If you are developing other leisure habits, then you have to steal time from those habits and give your time, full time, whatever time you get, to learn and to gain more and more knowledge. Okay. I think I have already completed. I have already gone through all the necessary parts of the essay. Do you have doubts, students? Anything that you want to ask? Do we need to discuss? Any discussion needed, students? Anything you want to ask, students, please do ask me. Don't remain so silent. Yes, anybody? Chandrasekhar, you're asking something?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Chandrasekhar.
The session was very good and it gave us some motivation.
Thank you so much, Chandrasekhar. I hope I made you understand at least something.
My question is, refer some good novel which we can read through internet.
Oh, acha, you want to read? Very good. Chandrasekhar, I'm happy to say that now only I spoke that this was a period, Samuel Johnson's period, when we started with novel. Chandrasekhar, if you're starting, first you can start with Robinson Crusoe of Daniel Defoe. Robinson Crusoe.
Can you send the link of the novel? Read it.
Okay, you can Google. You can just write it. It's very famous novel. So you go to Google and just type Robinson Crusoe. Summary will come up. If you want to read the summary, yes. If you want to read the whole novel, then I'll send you the PDF I have.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am.
Okay, and if you finish reading, do let me know. I'll send you some other books as well.
Thank you.
If you're interested in reading. Thank you so much, Chandrasekhar. Students, anything else? You are honor students. So, any other insight that you want to give, whatever I have taught, any other thing that you want to express that is there in your mind?
Can we have that kind of discussion, honor students? Okay. Heba madam, I have completed. Are you
Yes,
there?
ma'am. I think, yeah. Participants, I think Chandrasekhar, I would request you to share your personal views as well regarding what an obstruction do you consider that a learning might you have faced in your personal life as well, because okay, you are there now, so because normally all the essays are written on the personal life or the what you see in the society or the environment, so it would be a quite a good session if you want to, if you would be sharing your personal view as well.
Yes,
okay.
Personal view is always invited. There are so many hindrances, right, Heba madam, that we face in the process of learning and in the process of gaining education. There's so many things. You can add, you can also mail us, Chandrasekhar or other honor students, so that you can be more creative. You will be able to speak, you will be able to think. Because
one more question.
Yes, Chandrasekhar.
You just said a bad writer and good writer. So how can we know the difference between bad writer and good writer?
Yes, for that first you need to start to read. First you start reading.
Yeah.
Okay, as you proceed with your reading, you will understand. And I told you, no, that when you are looking at the difference between good writer and bad writer, what you can do,
yeah,
first of all is just see the review. Review is always there. Review is very easily available in our net. Online you can check reviews. Okay, if you find good reviews, good, you know, very prominent writers are speaking about that book, then that must be good. Another thing, Chandrasekhar, that all books are not, you know, most of the books are good, quality things are there, but sometimes they don't interest us. Okay. Suppose, for example, my interest is, if I'm in English honors, then my interest is, suppose I'd say literature. Language part, I have no much idea. So it also depends, our reading depends upon our interest.
Yeah.
You're getting my point. So first thing is,
yes,
that you see the review, always see the review. See if it,
yes,
is a bestseller, international bestseller or national bestseller. Then also sometimes it happens, Chandrasekhar, that a book is not that famous, but you like it. That also,
yeah,
happens. That also happens. That it is not getting much name and fame, but if you personally read it, you like it. So first look at your likes, what you like. Okay. And, you know, you can assess through your what you like. And then you turn to the reviews.
Thank you, ma'am.
Got that? Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, Chandrasekhar. Heba madam, are we going to continue with the session or I think I have already done with it.
Yeah, ma'am. If it's done, then why are we continuing?
Okay. No, I'm sitting because people may have doubt if they are want to ask.
Okay. Ma'am, okay. Chandrasekhar isn't having any doubt. He might have got it cleared.
Chandrasekhar, yes. He wants to have a clear idea.
Doubt,
yes?
Okay. His voice is not clear. Thank you, ma'am, for such a wonderful session by adding the different context into consideration, how you have taken Christopher Marlowe's essays like Necromancy, how this education itself was acting as a blunder in the very personality,
yes,
into account. So it's not just that people are learned. We need to be learned as a good citizen or a good character need to be built too.
Exactly.
The motive behind learning. It's not just adding knowledge and piles of books and writing. This we need
right.
to be a good person as well.
Yes,
so
and that is what, madam, that is why it is the age of reasoning where Samuel Johnson belonged. And that is what he is trying to reason out.
Yes, ma'am. We do agree to that too. In present context as well.
Yes,
so it was a very wonderful session it was, and by having you in our session, it added a value to it. So thanks
thank
a lot.
So thank you so much.
And participants as well. Yeah, thanks
thank
to one
you
and
so
all.
Much. Thank you.
Okay.